knew I missed Jack, but you know the moment I realized how much I missed him?
Is it the tap and the bum?
Tap and the bum.
They've really missed the tap and the bum.
Let's go!
Ladies and gentlemen, it's a little ridiculous.
Good boy.
Play all the hits! Left Toronto Maple Leafs. Let me finish. How am I supposed to go to bed after watching that?
I'm quite hyped. With you wherever you are, welcome to LFR.
Victory puppies, Iggy! There's a few rules in life, okay? We don't poop in the blue room. Rabbits are not acceptable gifts for the neighbors. And we don't test the Wayne train. Ever.
Before we talk about that big Leafs win over the Philadelphia Flyers, let's talk a little bit about Betway. Betway is one of the most trusted names in sports betting, both in Canada and around the world. I trust them more than I trust my voice not to crack right now. Betway is the sports betting app that puts you, the customer, at the forefront. It's simple, fun, and safe to bet with Betway. With a large selection of sports and betting options, as well as strong promotions and fair odds, what are you waiting for? Head on over to Betway and bet your way. They didn't tell me to do the finger point, I just did it. Must be 19 years or older to play. Please bet responsibly.
Leafs win! Leafs win!
That's okay.
I'm getting annoyed. My voice keeps cracking when I do that because I get to say it so often. Leafs win! That'll do. 6-3 over the Philadelphia Flyers.
So close to back-to-back 7-3 victories.
Okay, I think it's fitting that this game looked the way I do right now. I don't think all the makeup in the world could hide how pink my nose is. I think it's an allergy attack. I have been leaking brain matter out of my nose all day. And much like how I am currently, this game was a hot mess. Even the moments where goals were not scored were a hot mess. Passes are sloppy, they're getting picked off, and then those passes that are picked off are turned into scoring chances that are completely flubbed. And this is going both ways, but mostly the Leafs turning it over in the defensive end, and then the Flyers going, hey, we're about to score, and then very not scoring. Which suited Jack Campbell just fine, because by the way, Jack Campbell started this game. He's back, and his workload was lighter than it was before he went down with an injury. He only had to make one spectacular save that the team didn't deserve at all. I should also mention Nick Abruzzese playing in his first NHL game with his first shift in the first period. I didn't know this until Kevin Papetti on Twitter tweeted this. The St. Louis Blues gave the Leafs a fourth round pick for Nikita Soshnikov. That fourth round pick was in 2019. The Blues won the cup. So with the last pick of the fourth round in 2019, the Leafs selected Nick Abruzzese, who this past season was the captain of Harvard and a US Olympian. Not bad. Also worth mentioning, Keith Yandel's Iron Man streak comes to an end. He was a healthy scratch in this game. Flyers rookie defenseman Ronnie Attard getting his first ever NHL game in this one, just like Nick Abruzzese. Now, I think we're going to see a little bit of slander sent his way, which I think is going to be unfair because he gets into the lineup and Yandel's streak comes to an end. And with his 15 minutes plus of ice time, he was a -4. Listen, the Flyers are not making the playoffs, so the players they are putting into the lineup, the guys who are playing their first ever NHL game, are not necessarily put in there to be world beaters. They're not even necessarily put in there because they'll look great, or they're not even necessarily put in there because they're the best option. They're put in there because the Flyers, who are rebuilding, need to evaluate. And humans, they don't gain experience like Pokemon do. For those of you who don't understand that reference, in Pokemon, you go around fighting other Pokemon, and when you win, you gain experience and level up. Yeah, that's how Pokemon level up. Generally speaking, humans level up by getting their butts kicked. And -4 is an education. And I talk about Abruzzese and Attard because there was nothing else to really talk about from the first period, apart from how bad of hockey it was. Don't believe me? Go watch the Sportsnet highlight pack on the game. There's nothing from the first! It starts in the second! Second period, the Flyers finally open up the scoring. Defensive zone draw, but it's the big line on the ice for the Leafs. Should be fine. It wasn't. Off the draw, TJ Brody attacks the point. Several Leafs attack the point. So, it's Justin Hall and Austin Matthews back there. Nobody, and I mean nobody, picks up Kevin Hayes. He gets the pass for the tap-in goal. I mean, Jack Campbell is just coming back from a rib injury! Stop making him be superhuman! Just under 4 minutes in, the Flyers lead 1-0. So after a sloppy first period, I'm talking on the stream, watch a Leafs game with Steve Dangle on the Sportsnet YouTube channel. And I'm like, okay, a week ago today, the Leafs lost to the Montreal Canadiens. Isn't it unbelievable that that was a week ago? But the Montreal Canadiens at the time were last, they're second last now. The Leafs, since then, 3 great wins, 3 chippy wins against really good teams. Florida, Boston, I wouldn't quite put the Jets in that category, but it was a chippy game and one that they needed to win for their pride. Leafs and Flyers just Both teams could barely convince themselves to hate each other. So I'm looking at that and I'm like, okay, I understand the flavor of this game. I'm not overly concerned. Then the Flyers go up 1-0, and the longer that they stayed up 1-0, I'm like, okay, this is bad. The Leafs are losing to the Flyers. They've been losing to the Flyers for a while, and they're getting outshot! But then, what's that? Leaf Nation wondered as they slowly put their hand down on the track and felt the rumble! TJ Brody springing Wayne Simmonds on a miracle breakaway! Simmonds, how does he stay onside? How does he fight off the defender? How does he score that goal? Carter Hart kind of beat himself on that one a little, but Wayne Simmonds put himself in a position to have good luck. He made his luck. Cha-cha! The Wayne train! With his fifth of the season, first in 32 games, I believe, and the Leafs tie the game. Barely over a minute later, with Ilya Lyubushkin back in the lineup, guess what? They go back to Timothy Liljegren with Mark Giordano. I like me some Liljegren with Mark Giordano. Liljegren likes Liljegren with Mark Giordano. So much so that he puts the puck on well wide on purpose for a bunting tap-in, except that's not what happened. Again, on the stream, we were debating what on earth happened there. I believe it was originally called a Michael Bunting goal, but as I look on NHL.com right now, it's Timothy Liljegren, which means Carter Hart beat himself literally this time. He didn't take himself out of the way, he literally tapped it into his own net. Shame for the guy, because I thought, well, until it got out of hand at the end, he was having a good game, but now all of a sudden, the Leafs have the lead! 3 minutes later, here come the Flyers! Oh, it's gonna be one of these ones! First and foremost, Sheldon Keefe has the blender out. He changed up the top three lines so many times that I couldn't tell what was an accidental combination because of a line change, or what was on purpose. But on this one, William Nylander is out with Austin Matthews. William Nylander blocks a shot. William Nylander did not look comfortable. With the team all out of sorts, Matthews can't catch up to Ivan Provorov, who scores. It's tied 2-2. And all of a sudden, both teams are starting to look like they care. So, if you watch the stream, what did I say? All right, listen. We know, in terms of your matchup against each other, nothing is at stake. The Leafs are going to make the playoffs. The Flyers are not. But since you're both here, and since the game's tied heading into the third, you might as well try to leave with 2 points. So, with the Leafs playing a little aloof, a little fast and loose for the first two periods, especially the first, they should dominate the third. And oh baby, is that what happened? So the top line, the big version of the top line, Bunting, Matthews, Marner, is reunited. Bunting is in on this, but specifically the duo of Matthews and Marner bully the entire Flyers roster here. First of all, Matthews with the puck, skating up the wall and towards the point. Guess what? Hard turn, he hands it off to Marner, who nobody is paying attention to because they decided to double-team Matthews. Within milliseconds, Marner catches Lindblom just standing totally flat-footed, so he's got momentum, and Lindblom has no hope of catching him. Then Mitch Marner comes in, he knows how to shoot! And Carter Hart, it's just full Sunday service, just full church goalie right there. That is one of my favorite terms that I ever heard from a goalie, and it's a goalie who spends all their time on their knees. If I'm not mistaken, the first time I ever heard the term church goalie was Steve Mason talking about himself, and that's not me making a joke, I'm being serious. Marner gets Carter Hart to bite so hard that he does the splits, but that's not even the guy he got the most. The guy Marner got the most was every Flyer on the ice. Don't believe me? Each and every player wearing a black jersey is looking at Mitch Marner, and if you look to the left of the screen, that guy has 50 goals! Well now, 51, because Marner sets him up, and Matthews, it's that isn't fair. That isn't fair. What's with all these cutesy nicknames? Oh, Magic Marner, Marner the Magician. That there is Shang Tsung. Your soul is mine. If Shang Tsung just sort of liked walking his dog and playing COD. Like, listen, individually, the top story to follow this year on the Leafs is Austin Matthews. He became the first Leaf in, like, what, a quarter century to score 50 goals in a season. He might score 60. He's only 9 goals away. Please don't lose sight of the unreal season that Mitch Marner is having. Holy cow, this guy is playing the best hockey of his career. Speaking about the best hockey of their career, the Leafs on the penalty kill, on nuts. Wait a sec, their penalty kill rules! Morgan Rielly, with his 49th assist of the season, did you know that he has 49 assists? Sets up Pierre, I don't know where this came from, Engvall. He takes off on a 2-on-1 with Colin Blackwell. Does he pass it to him? Does he? The Flyers defender actually does a pretty good job cutting off the pass. pass, but man, that's a lot of net for Pierre to shoot at. And dude, did I not say it? Did I not say it all season long? The dude is the tallest player on the team at 6'5". He is also one of the heaviest. Have you seen him with his shirt off? It was in the Amazon documentary. Dude is jacked. He's also one of the fastest, if not the fastest guys on the entire team. He can shoot. Why do I feel so uncomfortable with him in the lineup? Because he used to make weird decisions. And when he stopped doing that, he's just kind of a really good player. This dude went from healthy scratch to... Seriously, dude's a monster and he's a huge part of the Leafs. Unbelievable, spectacular penalty kill. That's their 12th shorthanded goal of the season, the top shorthanded goal total in the NHL. Now, Provorov did manage to get his second of the game. I thought it was a tip from McEwen, but according to NHL.com, it wasn't. Watching the replay, it definitely hit something, changed direction on Campbell. But then less than 90 seconds later, the big line gets back out there and they're like, no, we're trying now. Before the actual goal, you want to see something funny? This 4-on-1 with Marner, Matthews, Bunting, and Riley wasn't the goal! Bunting almost scored, he hit the side of the net, but that's not even a shot on goal! Bunting manages to keep it alive though, the Leafs manage to keep it alive, Mitch Marner fires it on from the point, and Morgan Riley bangs it in from in front, a little role reversal, his 9th of the season. He's been cooking lately, the Leafs are up by 2. And nearly exactly 2 minutes later, I don't know who told you John Tavares was slumping still, but it's out of date. You should cover him. Goals in 3 of his last 4 games, and 4 goals in his last 4 games. Johnny Toronto is, back. He also never left. Oh, and lastly, after trying to fight each other earlier, Zach McEwen finally got his wish and got to fight Wayne Simmonds. And McEwen said, "Hey Wayne, I got your old number." And Wayne said, "Yeah, and you can get these hands too." Except he doesn't yell, he says it calmly, which is, it's worse. It's way worse. Dude, that guy's... Okay, people talk about how tough he is, and like, he's hard to beat in fights. Specifically, that uppercut is gruesome. Why would anyone... McEwen voluntarily signed up for that twice in the same game. Why? It just capped off a big 2 points for the Leafs in their desperate attempt to get home ice advantage in the first round. Big win for Nick Abruzzese in his first game in front of the family, and Jack Campbell wins his return. I can barely hold it together. I'm not getting emotional because Abruzzese won in front of his family. I literally cannot continue shooting. I need to wrap this up soon and blow my nose for the rest of the night. This is awful. Questions. How many salt and vinegar crispers can I eat in an hour before my mouth rots? First of all, some of you are like, crispers, I've heard of those. Are those like those chips? They're not chips, they're not crackers, they're crispers. Also, I looked it up, it was available on Google, 72. What's he digging for? Oh, Michael Bunting. Oh, let's take this off the screen after we leave it there for a few more. Yeah. Okay, now you can take it off. I saw this on the stream and I was like, did everyone else see that? And apparently they did, and now they're seeing it again. We still love you, Mike. Can anyone freely cross-check people while they celebrate a goal? Or is that just a specific situation? Yeah, no, it's just allowed. It's allowed. Kevin Hayes cross-checked Michael Bunting after the Matthews goal. Now, granted, Bunting can be a disagreeable player to play against, but during the celebration, Kevin Hayes just skated over and he just cross-checked Michael Bunting. Just cross-checked him. It's allowed. And I know it's allowed because it wasn't a missed call. People talk about missed calls. Refs will miss a call like they didn't see it. They're looking right at it and determined, no, this is fine. It's allowed. So here's the thing. The Leafs' next game, if the other team scores on them and Bunting skates over to one of the players in the celebration scrum and he cross-checks him in the arm, if he gets a penalty for that, my question is why? Why? How come? A little consistency, guys. It was allowed in this game. You didn't miss it. You saw it. Why wasn't it called? Why was this one called? It's allowed. You told me it was allowed by not calling the other one. Like... Someone asked me today, like, Steve, like, I miss when you used to like hockey. I love hockey. I wish hockey would get out of its own way. Like, people are talking about, like, oh, what rule changes should the NHL make? Rule changes? There's already one for cross-checking. There's definitely one for cross-checking when not in play. Like, this is not hard. This isn't hard. Well, how much of the game do you want to be on the power play? Literally, just don't cross-check people after the whistle. During a goal celebration. When the entire building is looking at them. Are you dumb? And the answer is, no. No, Kevin Hayes is not dumb for doing that because it's literally allowed. And this is why I always talk about the Leafs like going confetti gloves on someone and like whatever, because those things are allowed. You know the saying, if you're not cheating, you're not trying? It doesn't even get that far with the NHL. It's if you're not trying, you're not trying. Brad Marchand cross-checked on Tavares multiple times after the whistle. You know why? It's allowed. It's just allowed. And here it is again, Kevin Hayes. It's allowed.
Oh, here's a Leaf fan whining again.
Is everyone all right?
It's always been this way. It's always been wrong. Grow up.
Can we officially call Liljegren a steal? Let's be careful. Liljegren was the 17th pick in the 2017 draft 5 years ago. He has been unreal this season and maybe the team's most improved player. And there are definitely players who were drafted above him who have not even really started their NHL career, and they haven't had as good an NHL career as Liljegren has so far, short as it is. But like Josh Norris was 2 picks later, Robert Thomas was 3, Jason Robertson picked at 39, that's a steal. But I'm not ready to call him a steal because he doesn't need to be a steal, he just needs to be Timothy Liljegren, which right now for the Leafs is enough. And lastly, is asking a question 52 minutes after you tweeted this too late? Usually yes, but tonight no. Thanks for asking. So, that is it for this one. Thank you very much for watching. Click like if you like this video. Click subscribe if you really liked it. Tell all your friends. I'm just going to blow my nose for the next, like, 48 hours.